Well, good evening. I want to welcome you to the 45th annual Foard Lecture. This is the longest running endowed lecture that we have in the school, and I just want to thank you all for being here tonight. I think it's going to be a great evening, and we're really glad that you're here. Each year, the Foard Lecture gives us a chance to celebrate a couple of our faculty and alumni, and to get together, to bring people from, not just from the school, but friends, people from the community, and to talk about an important topic. And tonight's topic is really important, and we have a wonderful speaker, and you'll be hearing from him very soon. This year, we scheduled the Foard Lecture to fit with our alumni board meeting and our Public Health Foundation board meeting. And we're so grateful to all of you who are on those boards and our advisory council. You make such a difference in the school. Your fundraising, your support, your advice, you just really make a difference. And as you walk around later, you'll notice that some of our folks, including members of these boards, have special ribbons that reflect their contributions. And others have ribbons on their name badges that reflect generous gifts to the school. Members of the Rosenau Society have given $1,000 or more of unrestricted funds, and some of their funds go to annual fund scholarships, which are really critical for our students, and we're so grateful to you for these. And I think your investment in our students really pays off. We were talking earlier about the fact that yesterday at the Graduate School Awards ceremony, our students from our school took a third of the North Carolina Impact Awards, reflecting the impact of their research on North Carolina. I think a real benefit to everybody in this state. Some of the ribbons reflect the donation and commitment of scholarships and professorships and specialty funds like those for travel, and these are also so important to us. And then the Cornerstone Society ribbons signify people who've made generous gifts to the building fund. And you can't have a school without a building, and we really are grateful to them. The Girard Society ribbons are for those who've made plans to provide for the school in their wills to create a lasting legacy. And I'm grateful to every donor, no matter how large or how small, but tonight, especially to those whose gifts are marked by your ribbons. We can't do what we do. We can't be the top public school of public health without your support. So we'll introduce our speaker in a few minutes, but first we have two really special awards to present to two people who've made a real difference in public health. Professor Steve Meshnick will present the Barr Award, and Professor Diane Ward will follow immediately to present the Greenberg Award. And thank you both very much.
So it's truly a pleasure for me to present the Harriet Hylton Barr Distinguished Alumni Award to Will Milhous. He's an old friend and an old colleague. Will graduated from the School of Public Health in 1983 and then joined the Walter Reed Army Institute of Research, or RARE, first as chief of the malaria lab, and then he worked his way up to director and research coordinator and spent about 25 years there. And Will has personally had a huge impact on public health. RARE, in the 1980s and the 1990s, malaria had become really a neglected disease. Everyone had sort of forgotten about it, public health agencies, drug companies, and we were really in very dire shape. Chloroquine, which was the main drug, was really losing its efficacy due to resistance. And so Will led a team of researchers at RARE in drug development, and he was one of the sort of leaders of a whole new group of people who were developing new drugs. And one of the drugs that he has contributed to the development was the artemisinin derivatives. And these are now the first-line drugs in most of the world, and they've saved hundreds of thousands of lives. Many teams of scientists played role in development, but I think Will played a particularly pivotal role. Will and his team also developed several other new drugs which may soon be marketed. Will is a born leader who can navigate bureaucracies, conflicts, and swollen egos smoothly and with a sense of humor. His leadership has been recognized by numerous awards, including the American Society of Tropical Medicine and Hygiene's prestigious Bailey Ashford Medal in 1993 and the Joseph LaPrince Medal in 2009. I first met Will in 1985, right after he joined RARE, And as a dyed-in-the-wool New Yorker and left-wing academic, I was really skeptical that I could develop a relationship with this man. But he proved me wrong very quickly and has become a very, very important friend of mine and colleague. He and I have worked in the same fields for most of our lives, and he's often shared data, insights, and reagents with me. He's one of the most generous scientists I've ever known. He's also a dedicated teacher and mentor for many young scientists, including several of my former students. In 2007, he moved to the University of South Florida College of Public Health to become a professor and associate dean for research, and really helped establish the school as a global leader in emerging infectious disease research and training. I can't think of a more worthy recipient of this award.
This is a most special moment. When I won the Greenberg Award, I thought I'd died and gone to heaven. And, you know, to hear all these accolades back in 1984 about being what I thought was a mediocre graduate student was just absolutely unbelievable. But I think that event in my life, in terms of my own self-confidence about my science and my inspiration to work in tropical medicine, is pretty much what took me on an incredible ride for the rest of my life. So I'm highly indebted to any and all of you that helped me get through that graduate training. I need to make a special note of dedication to my wife, Virginia Milhous, who's here. On Monday, 30 years ago, we left to go to Walter Reed, and I can assure you, out on the highway, there are fingernail scrapes. From my daughters in Virginia. She never forgave me for leaving Chapel Hill. And if I don't get her back to Tampa by 10:30 in the morning, she probably won't even go back. So just a great person to share a life with. And here tonight is a most special mentor. That's Professor Norman Wethley. Last year, he had a former student to win this award. But Norman was a phenomenal mentor to me. And just set me on a track with a lot of great people from Burroughs Wellcome, the College of Medicine, the College of Public Health, that just kind of set me on a path and gave me self-confidence and always gave the brightest ideas and the most lucrative types of experiments, just always pushed me forward to those. And I think that's where this school really does well, mentorship, mentorship, mentorship. So it's been a great ride for me. If any of you guys get malaria, come see me. But I'm enjoying academic public health, and I meet on occasions with your senior leadership here at our meetings at ASPH. So a remarkable ride. Thank you so much.
They've given us, the introducing folks, 3 minutes, and so I've started to think, how can I reduce Steve Zeisel to 3 minutes? So I thought I'd tell you really three things about Steve that epitomizes the reason that he's been recognized this year as the Barnard J. Greenberg Award recipient. I'm not going to talk about his 170 research publications and the 35 doctoral students and postgraduates that he's mentored over the years. But I would like to say that Steve joined the School of Public Health 22 years ago as the chair of the Department of Nutrition. And at that time, the department had 11 faculty. Today we have 35 faculty. Steve implemented the first PhD program for the Department of Nutrition. He increased the external funding from $500,000 to $20 million in external funds. And most importantly, Recently, the Department of Nutrition was recognized as the very first among 144 departments of nutrition across the U.S., and I think we owe Steve Zeisel the dedication for that. I'd also like to recognize the work that he's done to infuse nutrition into the training of medical students. Steve led the development of the Nutrition in Medicine series of educational materials that has been now implemented in a large number of medical schools across the world. Last year, 7,000 medical students were trained in this way. And lastly, and maybe most important, is Steve's academic work and his research in the area of the nutrient choline. The work that he has done over the past 30 years has led to the recognition of choline as a critical dietary nutrient and has been included in the requirements for American diet. Also recognizing that infant formula was not as good as it should be, and that in 2007, infant formula would have to have the addition of choline. This work has really been spearheaded by Steve's research. And lastly, today he continues to work in this area, looking at the role of the nutrient choline in fetal alcohol syndrome and autism. Collectively, Steve has been an enduring influence in the School of Public Health and deserving of the Greenberg Award. Thank you.
Well, it's really an honor to get this award. But really, I should be giving out the awards to the students, postdocs, staff members who work so hard to make me look like I know what I'm doing, to the faculty in the Department of Nutrition, especially Diane Ward, who nominated me for this award, but to the faculty who gave me the opportunity to be part of and to help build the world-class Department of Nutrition that's in the School of Public Health today. To the faculty that currently are part of the UNC Nutrition Research Institute, helping to build a world-class research center focused on nutrition and nutritional variability and genetics. And I think most of all to my wife, Susan, my daughters, Kathy and Becky, for giving me the time to be a professor and do the job that lets me wake up every morning with the thought that I might discover something new today that'll make a difference for the world. Being a professor is a great job, and getting this award makes it even better. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Diane and Steve, and congratulations, Will and Steve. Really well deserved. We're so excited that John LaPook is with us tonight, and only after he accepted our invitation did we learn that he's really a distant relative of the school. Apparently, it was his uncle, Merrill Eisenbud, who some of you may have known, who sparked his interest in science, which allegedly, and I hope it's true, began with the gift of a rock collection. Is that true? Which I think should give every parent here some comfort knowing that serendipity can spark such a wonderful career. And Professor Eisenbud was a renowned environmental scientist who was the first health and safety chief of the Atomic Energy Commission and New York City's EPA, and then he came down here and joined our faculty and stayed here on the faculty until his death in 1997. So it's, I think it's an amazing coincidence, and maybe not such a coincidence. And one more piece of evidence to support my hypothesis that nearly everybody has some connection to our school. Well, I want to thank Joyce Fitzpatrick, because Joyce is really the rainmaker for this event, and she is going to introduce our speaker in a minute. Joyce is a communications executive and an expert in crisis communication, and she's really been doing a lot to help the university, and I'm personally so grateful for what she's doing. She's a Carolina alumna and a member of the Board of Advisors for the School of Journalism and Mass Communications, and she's going to have to leave in a few minutes after introducing John to go to their event tonight, since we all seem to pick exactly the same night for our events. She's been helping the university do an even better job of telling our stories, and I think for that we all owe her a debt. So Joyce, thank you so much, and we really appreciate everything you did to connect us to John LaPook. Thank you.
Good evening. At the University of North Carolina, there's a great tradition of collaboration and cross-fertilization. And nowhere is that more evident than between the Gillings School of Global Public Health and the UNC School of Journalism and Mass Communication. As a matter of fact, I saw Tom Linden in the audience tonight, who's a professor at our school in health communications. Certainly, as we speak, the American people are more interested in the health and well-being of their families and communities than in any other single issue that confronts our nation. As a graduate of the UNC School of Journalism and as a great admirer of the serious journalism that still may only exist at CBS News, I take great joy in introducing our honored guest speaker, who is both a physician and a journalist. Dr. Jonathan LaPook is the chief medical correspondent for CBS Evening News with Scott Pelley. Most recently, he has reported on a variety of fascinating stories, such as dispelling myths about mental illness and criminal behavior, the skyrocketing costs of dementia treatment, and the recent small drop in cancer death rates. He's a board-certified physician in internal medicine and gastroenterology. He's also a clinical professor of medicine at Columbia University Medical Center and has an active medical practice in New York City. In addition, he has done extensive work in the field of medical computing, including development of the first electronic textbook of medicine and writing a medical practice management software package that he sold in 1999 to WebMD. He graduated with honors from Yale University and Columbia College of Physicians and Surgeons and has been at Columbia since receiving his MD in 1980, and we're glad to know he has a Carolina connection as well. Please join me in a warm Carolina welcome to Dr. John LaPook.
Thank you, Joyce Fitzpatrick and Jerry Salak and everybody else who arranged me coming down here. I'm really honored to be here at the Frederick Foard Lecture, and I have to say that I did Google just to make sure, you know, who is he, and he's obviously a tremendous figure in public health, and also especially with Native American Indians advancing their public health. So I'm really honored to be able to give this. I know we're a little pressed for time. I'd like to have about 2.5 hours. Lest you think this is a canned talk, when I got the call that they wanted me to do this, I figured, well, sure, I'll give the talk, and I hung up, and I said, but I actually don't have a talk to give. So I was thinking, what would be relevant for here? So this is the we're taking it on the road here. This is the first time. I just put this together for here. If you like it, great. If you don't, Michael Radutsky is the CBS producer who actually made the connection. I'll give you his email address afterwards, and you can email him. So let's just get started right away. And I'll just give you a little précis of what it's going to be. I'm going to just give you a quick brain dump of what was going through my head at the very beginning of this, and then we'll come forward and I'll show you a bunch of clips. And I have about a half hour or something like that, so I'll try to keep it to time. So I came up with the title, Public Health at the Intersection of Media and Medicine. How I became an accidental journalist and public health communicator. Although it's interesting, my Uncle Merrill, who, by the way, was at Hiroshima and Chernobyl and was a real public health guy, maybe it runs in the blood somehow, but I certainly never thought of myself as a public health person. I was a doctor. I was seeing people one-on-one. Until, I guess it was March of 2006, I get a phone call from Katie Couric, who I knew through various connections. I had written, years ago, I had written, been an editor of the Columbia Home Health Guide, and I was on the Today Show, and I met her. She was pregnant with one of her kids, and we became friends. So she called me and said, how would you like to be the medical correspondent for the CBS Evening News? I said, do you have to know anything? She said, no. I said, great, I can do that. So, interestingly, at the time, I was thinking about public health issues. If you remember back in 2006, these were, you know, we had had anthrax, we had had all of these different things, and I had written, put this all together in a piece I wrote for WebMD magazine about how I was communicating all of this to my patients. And I'll quote from myself, okay, which is really, I don't know, a tacky thing to do, but at the beginning, after several years of trying to educate myself in order to answer questions for my anxious patients about nerve gas, anthrax, swine flu, mad cow disease, West Nile virus, SARS, and now bird flu, I find myself thinking wistfully back to 1963 when, as a 10-year-old, all I had to worry about was total nuclear annihilation. So I was thinking about the issues of public health back then, and about communication. And so maybe it was meant to be that now suddenly I had the opportunity to communicate to a lot more people. But interesting, I had been noodling about these issues of how you communicate in a responsible way. The practice of medicine and the practice of journalism, so I'm trying to meld these. I had no training in journalism. It was so these are the things that I was asking myself, and I'm just going to take you through sort of the journey at the beginning. There's going to be a lot of questions with a lot fewer answers. But just to give you a sense of the journey and the questions I was asking myself. So the practice of medicine and the practice of journalism, they're similar but completely different. The similar is first do no harm. Gather data accurately, and that's incredibly important. Never pollute the database. Be skeptical. Does this sound too good to be true? Really? Really? Keep an open mind. Convey perspective. The difference is, on television, you've got about 2 minutes to do all that. Of course, in the doctor's office, it's about, a minute and a half. So actually, you have a little more time on TV. But to try to get this message into 2 minutes, I mean, it's a challenge. And because of that 2 minutes, by the way, you know, sometimes you leave things out and you feel bad about it, and there's just no way to get them in. You're a reporter, not an advocate. This is a huge difference. Something I've struggled with, I've thought about. Sometimes I've probably stepped over the line a little bit, you know, when I'm on it. Say, well, you know what I do? You have to. I'm always thinking: Am I declaring myself? Am I a reporter here? Am I the doctor with the opinion? Am I using this as a bully pulpit? And Gary Switzer, I have to say, who's a health journalist, has pointed this out to me pointedly on an occasion, and I think he's right about that. But it's something that it's not natural to make that distinction all the time. There's a team working on every story. I cannot tell you how important this is. When you're in medicine, it's one-on-one. You're in the office with the patient, and your precious patient, and you are their advocate. You work like hell to make sure that they're not eaten up by the system. And then if you need a consult, you have the world of consults out there, but you don't necessarily send them to a consult. It's CBS. Nothing gets on the air unless a bunch of people have seen it. So when you see me up there doing a story, it's not me. It's me, it's my three medical producers, it's my research team of four people who are sitting in a room all day long just checking the facts. They're the people in the fishbowl, these are the producers who are seniors who look at it and say, you know what, I know that makes sense to you, but really I don't know what the hell you're talking about. And let's make that more so that people who don't have PhDs and MDs can actually understand it. I try to do that myself anyway as a filter, but there are times when I'll write a story and they'll say, you know, you can't use that word. And then everybody else at CBS, I don't want to make this a commercial for CBS, but I will make it a commercial for CBS because I will say that when you walk in there, you have this sense of the tradition, Edward R. Murrow, Walter Cronkite, all the rest, and you don't want to mess it up. It's very serious. People take it incredibly seriously. I know the media sometimes may be portrayed in a way that devil may care, but I can tell you that in my colleagues, everybody really cares. It has to be right, not almost right, absolutely correctly right. And of course, you're not always right, but the ethic is there, and the institutional memory is there, and that's really important. You can hurt a lot more people. I could hurt one person, or I could hurt the 7 million people who are watching the evening news and the 27 million who hear me on radio. I never realized, after every show, after every broadcast, I go down to radio and I do radio. I never realized the reach of radio. So a lot of people, if you say one thing wrong, you not only can hurt somebody then, but you're polluting the database. I think about what I'm doing as I'm talking to 7 million individual patients. And if I do it wrong, I could do real harm, real serious harm, and I've lost sleep over it. You know, did I word that the right way? I also think about it in terms of history, that 100 years from now, people are going to be looking back, and they're going to think, this is a record of what we did, and did I say it correctly? Did I say it right? Challenges, simplification, but not oversimplification. Statistics, we all know that problem. If something, you know, you can hype something, you say, the death rate has doubled. Wow, panic. It's gone from 1 in a million to 2 in a million. Absolute versus relative. And that's something that journalists and media fall into all the time, a trap. The curse of the medical 180. There are times we've all had it. You know, the Women's Health Initiative, you told us to take hormones. Now, we shouldn't take hormones. We should take vitamins. We shouldn't take, we should get a mammogram. We shouldn't get, and you want to take a brick and throw it through the television set. And I'm the guy you're throwing the brick at. So we understand that. And in fact, it makes us shy away from stories sometimes, but we have to not shy away from those stories. We just have to make sure that we give the arc, the perspective, because that is what we can do. Tough to do it in 2 minutes. But we have to explain, you know what, it's medical knowledge. There was an Annals article a number of years ago. It said half of medical knowledge changes every about 5.5 years. It's normal. We're not drilling holes in people's heads to let out the evil vapors anymore. That's a good thing. And we have to communicate that change is a good thing. But again, put it in perspective so that people don't think we're just changing our minds all the time. Questions I've asked myself. Is this research ready for prime time? It's cruel to present a mouse study about Alzheimer's drug that is maybe 15, 20 years away from anything, if it ever is going to be anything, and go on and say there's a possible cure for Alzheimer's. It's just cruel and it's wrong. So is it ready for prime time? Am I hyping the story? We'll talk about that later when the first example, which will be H1N1. Ironically, on a day when H7N9 in China is rearing its head and we're starting to hear the same rumblings, what am I leaving out because of time? There are times when I absolutely have to leave out crucial information, and it's really upsetting to me, like the cost of the medication that I'm just talking about, or a side effect or something. There's just not enough time. Literally, it's a 22-minute broadcast, and it comes in, and they cut stuff. And I get to say what is cut. We argue about it. But, you know, for me, I'd like it to be a 5-minute segment. It's a 2-minute segment, and maybe a minute and a half segment. Am I avoiding a story because it doesn't make for good TV? And I reminded myself, on March 18th, we did a story about mammography. You remember in 2009, the recommendations of the United States Preventive Services Task Force changed, and they said that, among other things, that you could get from 50, women starting at 50 should get it every 2 years instead of every 1 year. And at that point, people went nuts. You're killing us. This is a terrible thing. This was on the front page of everything that led the news. And now, 4 years later, a very large study came out which actually said that, you know what, when you do it every 2 years, you're not missing, you're not having any more advanced tumors. But it was kind of a murky story because there was an asterisk. If you're a woman with dense breasts, then maybe you should get ultrasound. But then you get a lot of false positives. But then there's 3D digital mammography. But. And so it's kind of an icky story. It's a tough story. It's a little murky. And it's not the beautiful, crisp story with a lot of great pictures that we like to present. And there's actually a discussion we had in the fishbowl about whether to do it or not. And I said, you know, you can't have the headline be on, you know, the one story be on page one and then the follow-up be on page 42. You know, we raised this question 4 years ago. It is a difficult issue. We just have to address it. And this is what they do. And I mean, I really do. I love the people I work with for this reason, is that they push back. We push back on each other in a respectful way, and then if I make my argument, they say, okay, we're going to go with you. So it went on the air, and it wasn't the most clear answer, but it was where we were. Am I making myself part of the story? We'll get back to this, but this is something I think about all the time. All the time. If I'm in a story, if there's a story, is it really necessary if it involves patient care? Am I the only doctor there? Do the cameras have to be on me, or is there somebody else that can be on? And if the cameras are on me, is there secondary gain in it for me? Look at me. Look what a great doctor I am. You see what I'm doing here? See how much I care? So you really have to. It's a very tough trap. It's an easy trap to fall into, especially when they need your help. But then you can just communicate with your producer, which I've done, and said, you know what? Just here's the ground rules. I know it's great TV, but if I'm helping somebody, you're going to turn the camera somewhere else, or you're going to turn off the camera. Easier said than done. But anyway, more questions. Why am I not staying here and helping these people when I'm in Haiti, especially? You know, very tough to leave. I wanted to just, when I was in St. Mark's in the cholera, first day of the cholera outbreak, I wanted to just stay there and just put in some IVs. Finding characters. What constitutes informed consent for patients I interview? We'll get back to that. But if I'm interviewing somebody with schizophrenia, I got consent from his mother, you'll see, and from him. But do they really know, do I really know what the consequences are of putting them on TV? No, I don't know what the consequences are. If I'm in a courtyard in St. Mark's and I'm videoing a stand-up and I'm talking about something, as you'll see in a second, do I have permission from those people to be on TV? I mean, you would in New York, there's HIPAA, there's not in Haiti. Are they any less than we are? Should we be going? These are the questions that I ask myself. I don't have the answers, by the way. Do we always need to present both sides? There are those people who say that the world is round, and then, you know, there are people who say that it's flat. And particularly what comes to mind is the long debate about the link between that perhaps autism was caused by vaccines, childhood vaccines. And at what point, when you have more than 25 major studies that have been done to show that this is not a link, at what point do you just stop presenting both sides and say, look, here's what the science shows? So that's another question. Can I include my own patients in stories? Here I have an answer. No. And I thought about this, and there's been a time when a patient actually came to me, a very well-known patient, and it would be perfect for the story. And she came to me because the doctor I was dealing with about the story knew her, knew me. She said, oh, there's an intrinsic power relationship between me and my patients, and they want to please me. So I can't do the ask. And even in that situation, when she did the ask, I said no, because there may be an unconscious desire to please me. So I don't think that works. There may be some time where some event happens, some special circumstances, but I think in general, it's just not a good, it doesn't feel right. So let's just go to, I'm going to rush through now about, okay, a bunch of tape. H1N9, 42809. This is a piece I'm very proud of. Because at a time when people were running around with their heads turned, everybody was afraid, everybody was panicked, we did this piece, which I think was very balanced. However, before I start congratulating myself, we led the news that night with H1N1. We were the second piece, so the first story and the second. So it's a little cognitive dissonance, you know. You can have this great, you can have a very balanced piece that's logical and is not hyping, and I think you'll see we put it in perspective, and it's not really any different than the normal flu season. And at the same time, you're leading the news with it. So the message that's going to the public is, I better be worried, I better be very worried. So I'll just play this.
When Dr. Bruce Farber treated 8 New York students with confirmed swine flu, he was struck by a common thread.
What's remarkable is how unsick they are, as opposed to how critically ill many of the people that we hear in Mexico who have been diagnosed with this.
20 deaths in Mexico have been confirmed as swine flu, though there may be more than 100. But the lack of information makes it impossible to know if this virus is deadlier than the one seen in a regular flu season.
In an ordinary year, about one case in 1,000 is lethal. So if there was a small number of cases of flu in Mexico, then this is a very lethal virus. If in fact there was a large number of cases of flu, then maybe it's just an ordinarily lethal virus.
So far, there have been 64 confirmed cases of swine flu with no confirmed deaths in the U.S. To put this in perspective, anywhere from 15 to 60 million Americans get the flu every year, and an estimated 36,000 die. With so many unknowns, fear is running high, prompting some people to stock up on masks and antiviral drugs like Tamiflu.
Yesterday, everybody was looking to get Tamiflu. We had some in stock, but we haven't been able to obtain any from our wholesalers.
Experts warn that inappropriate use of Tamiflu could make it stop working.
Then the drug will not be useful for people who really need it.
Right now, there's enough medication to treat 50 million people.
This is a real epidemic, and it's actually a pandemic because it's spread throughout the world. But so far, it's mild, so it's not very much different.
What do you do about mistakes? The New York Times has this column, daily column, corrections, right? It totally adds to their credibility. Look how much these people care. And I will say that there was a time a few years ago we were doing the flu stories, and I said something wrong. It was up in a chart. I read it. It came out of my mouth. The second I said it, it didn't seem right, which was, I had basically implied that for kids, they needed to get the vaccine, if you're under eight, twice a year. Every year. It's really just twice a year, the first year, if you haven't had it for a couple of years. It's kind of confusing. But anyway, I said it in a way that I thought would leave people confused, thinking that perhaps they needed to get it twice a year. So I got home, I thought, I looked it up, I saw I was wrong, I was upset. And I called one of the producers, and she said, well, we'll correct it on the web. I said, like, you can't make the mistake in front of 7 million people and make the correction in front of 7,000 people. And so she said, well, this is the way it is. So I went to sleep. I got up. By the time I was on my way, I went to my practice in the morning because I see patients from 8 to noon or 1. By the time I came over, and I'm coming on 59th Street between 5th Avenue and 6th Avenue, and I'm getting myself more and more in a state. And I picked up the phone, and I called my wife on the cell phone, and I said, how would you feel if I quit CBS today? And she said, she knew what I was worried about, and she said, I'm with you. So I went in there, I went into the fishbowl, and I said to Rick Kaplan, who was the executive producer at the time, I said, we have to have a correction. Katie Kirk was still the anchor then. I said, we have to have a correction. Why? I said, because I made a mistake. He said, what's the worst thing that happened? I said, the worst thing that could happen is that a baby will die, because a mother will see that and say, well, vaccines, I kind of am worried about vaccines anyway. I don't want to give my kid a vaccine twice a year for 8 years. So they don't give the vaccine and the kid dies. He does the compile in about a thousandth of a second, turns to Chris Dynan, who is one, and says, Katie's making a correction tonight. I never got so much positive feedback after a broadcast than that broadcast when Katie made the correction. So this is something that, CBS has done this. I made another mistake last year. My only two mistakes, but I did say something wrong on the CBS this morning, and I did it again, and they corrected it the next day. And I think that's important, and it's something that we need to be not afraid to do. And I'm proud of CBS for that. Haiti gets into your heart and your soul. And the problem with Haiti, among all the other problems, is. When there was an earthquake and there were hundreds of thousands of bodies, that's an easy story. But nobody wants to go back and follow that arc and see a year later and 2 years later. And it's harder to do the story. And by the way, it's frustrating. And what's the matter with those Haitians? So I'll just show you.
3 months after January's devastating earthquake in Haiti, the medical crisis there remains desperate. Well, the situation in the capital is bad. In the northern city of Port-au-Prince, correspondent Dr. John LaPook found doctors and nurses going from crisis to crisis during his visit to Haiti on the long road back.
It's not scientific at all, but it works.
As a nurse working in northern Haiti, Melissa Curtis is trying to deliver a baby in primitive conditions.
Yeah, there's no reason why she hasn't had this baby. She's just exhausted.
In one corner of the room is a premature baby weighing less than 3 pounds. In the other is a mother struggling in labor. When the unborn baby's pulse drops, the only oxygen machine in this clinic is taken from the preemie and given to the mother.
I just spoke to the head nurse, and she said there's not any availability here of C-section, so what's going to happen is going to happen.
You'll find out what happens to the baby in a second. But that moment when that little contraption sucks oxygen out of the air, condenses, gives you a little bit of oxygen. When I saw, I actually was videoing that myself. I saw what they were doing, and I turned and I got that moment when they're taking the oxygen from a preemie and giving it to the mother was a stunning moment. When you saw me, that's me stunned, you know, and helpless. I've never felt so helpless in all my life, you know. That's what's going to happen today? This baby is going to die and this woman's going to die because we can't do a C-section because the hospital is 10 miles away and it's too bumpy and they don't even have a way to get, I mean, unbelievable. So then the following fall, cholera breaks out. This is St. Mark's, where the epicenter was, and I went down there. I said I got to go down there. This is where being a doctor helped, because they said, well, there'll be a little bit of cholera. And I said, no. I said, like, it is actually, and I wrote this, I mean, I blogged this, I said it on TV, it is magical thinking to think that this is not going to become endemic and is not going to go. It's scientifically almost impossible, because if you just look at the incubation period being 4 to 5 days, people are going to be healthy. They're going to go from one area to another area infected, and they're going to spread it. And by the way, there's no sanitation. So there's no chance this is not going to be a big story. So they sent me down there, and then they wanted to bring me back after one day. And I said, no, I'm staying. And they listened. So the discussion happens. But here I am. Remember I said about HIPAA and all that?
Local hospitals are overflowing. I walked around the sides of the building over here inside this emergency area, and in back around the left, there are people laid out all over the place in stretchers, cots, makeshift beds. Many of them have IVs. Some of them are just drinking fluids. It seems if you can get treatment early and appropriately, then you do well.
A main concern is limiting the spread of the disease. In a country with little infrastructure and poor roads, getting rapid medical attention is a
That was a tough story. Then I went back last January. Well, probably it's so cool. I'm leaving out the cool. It's so cool being the medical correspondent at CBS. You pick up the phone, people talk to you, you can learn things quickly. And one of the best things that's happened to me is that I got to meet Paul Farmer. And here's a little story.
The people of Haiti this month are marking the second anniversary of that massive 7.0 magnitude earthquake that killed 316,000 people and made 1 million people homeless. Tonight, our medical correspondent, Dr. John LaPook, has paid a return visit to the country trying to heal.
3 months after the earthquake in Haiti, we visited a makeshift clinic near the northern city of Port-de-Paix. This hospital was so poorly equipped, the only oxygen machine was taken from a premature baby to help save a woman in labor and her unborn child. The mother and her newborn survived. The premature baby died. Now, nearly 2 years later, these Haitians are laying the foundation of one of the largest, most sophisticated projects in Haiti, a state-of-the-art teaching hospital.
And there's oxygen outlets in the wall.
It's the mission of Dr. Paul Farmer to prevent any further deaths from such unacceptable causes as lack of proper equipment.
Is there any other facility in all of Haiti that's like this?
I doubt it. So there's a couple nice hospitals in Port-au-Prince, but they're very difficult to access for poor people.
Farmer is co-founder of Partners in Health, a nonprofit that's collaborated with the Haitian government to build a hospital that's free of charge to patients.
Paul, how does it make you feel to walk through this big, beautiful hospital?
About time is how I feel.
Farmer is fed up with a double standard in healthcare.
This is a serious problem in healthcare delivery, is setting standards based on whether or not someone's poor or a country's poor. People living in poverty and with sickness deserve something better than what they've been offered, which is the sharp end of a stick.
Dr. Farmer knows the challenges of getting resources directly to the Haitian people.
A lot of people in the United States say, Haiti, it's a lost cause. We've poured billions into that country, and it's just money that's going down the hole. It's wasted. What do you say to them?
What I would say to someone who said, Haiti's a lost cause, it's all wasted, I'd say, well, that's not our experience. I mean, we've built or rebuilt a dozen hospitals and have thousands of employees working in the public sector, all in Haiti. And, you know, so that's a successful experience.
What do you and your colleagues hope that you're giving birth to with all your efforts?
We want to be able to say, you know, just once that the quality of care we're giving to people living in abject poverty is as good as it would be if they were born in some ritzy part of Manhattan, say. I mean, that vision of equity and justice and decency is what we'd like to give birth to.
There's room to teach here.
This facility will also help teach a new generation of Haitian doctors and nurses to heal the wounds of a broken country. Dr. John LaPook, CBS News, Mibale.
I think that last statement about healthcare equity is the definitive statement I've ever heard talking about it. Talk about object. It's hard to be objective and be the reporter when you're talking to Paul Farmer, but guy is amazing. This is an example of, are you part of the story? You'll hear about it.
We continue now with the realization that in any devastation like Hurricane Sandy, there is pain and loss and tragedy. But there are also examples of extraordinary response. Joining me now is Dr. John LaPook. He is a medical correspondent for CBS Evening News with Scott Pelley and frequently appears on CBS This Morning. He's also a clinical professor of medicine at Columbia University Medical Center. He was on the ground at NYU Langone Medical Center shortly before midnight on Monday when power was lost and 300 patients needed to be evacuated.
We're hoping to find out more information from people here at the hospital. But as of now, as we understand it, an evacuation is either about to begin or is beginning very shortly. Sir, can you give me more information if you could just read live television?
I'm Dr. LaPook. I'm the medical correspondent here for the CBS Evening News.
This is good timing,
Doctor. Hi, I'm coming down here with Dr. Mark Machapin, who's the head of PI, and we heard about the power outage, and we're going to go in and we're going to see if we can help with the evacuation. Obviously, they need some hands.
Yeah, it certainly seems very daunting, and these people who are showing up to help in the evacuation don't even know what they're up against inside.
Right, and in fact, we just got here. We don't want to really delay, but okay, we're going to head inside, and then I'll report some more when I get some more information.
Thank you, Doctor.
All right.
very much indeed. Dr. LaPook, who's the medical correspondent for CBS News.
I am pleased to have him here at this table. Welcome.
So what happened there was that I got a thing on my iPhone saying there was the power's off at NYU. I said, oh my gosh, they're going to need to evacuate. I called Mark Machapin, who's the head of GI at NYU. I said, he said I have no way. I said, I'll take my car. I'll pick you up. I picked him up. I parked my car in the most ridiculous place ever, like on a sidewalk. But anyway, we went down there. Totally, I was thinking a little maybe a bit journalist, but I was thinking mostly just doctor. And I went in there and I saw this truck, the local, but he thought I was one of these guys wanting to be in the shot. I'm going like this. Finally, he recognized I had my glasses on. But then I went in there, and as I went in there, I realized I was in a tricky position because I helped with the evacuation. I had my iPhone right there. I won't lie to you and say that I wasn't thinking for a second of taking some amazing footage inside there as I was going up the staircases and people coming down on these little sleds. And I mean, there was a scene, and I was the only journalist in there, obviously. But they let me in really as a doctor. They knew who I was because I brought the dean out to be interviewed. They knew who I was, but it didn't feel right to video, and I didn't. And then the next day when we did a story about it, they said, well, you'll give a first-hand account, and you'll talk about how you helped with the rescue. And again, I said, you know, there's another story to be told. It's really, I don't need to be part of the story. And Scott Pelley, again, in a billionth of a second, said, of course, I get it. You know, we'll do a story about what happened. And that's what we did. And again, the sensibility there is so good with Scott and Pat Shevlin, who's our executive producer. I mean, they've been there a long time. They're news people. They get it. They get it. And they bring it to me, too. It's not like I'm coming to them with these. They'll say to me, wait a second, does that seem right? Or he's saying that right way. So I love that about the colleagues I work with. I'm not going to actually run this because there's not enough time. The information that we did a story about informed consent and unnecessary testing. Interestingly, today's New York Times, there was an article about informed consent, about the babies who were given oxygen therapy premature, and there's a question about whether they got correct informed consent. A month later, and unnecessary testing that goes on. You know, there's a $2.7 trillion healthcare, 18% of our GDP, and $750 billion of it is felt to be wasted. A good chunk of that is unnecessary testing. So the next month, when I happened to be interviewing the president in the Blue Room, the White House, I took the opportunity.
Let's talk about how you get rid of unnecessary procedures.
Yeah.
You've said that if doctors have the information, they'll do the right thing. And generally, I like to think, I'm a physician, I'm practicing, I like to think that's true. But actually, there are a lot of times when that's not the case. For example, angioplasties, elective angioplasties,
right,
where you open up a clogged artery in the heart.
Right.
It turns out that about 30% of them are unnecessary.
Right. Why are they still ordering, do you think?
I think that because they believe there's this thing about if an artery is closed, it's got to be better if it's open. Right. And it turns out that's not true. So how do you make that doctor do the right thing?
I have enormous faith in doctors. I think they always want to do the right thing for patients. But I also think, if we're honest, doctors right now have disincentives to making the better choices in the situations you talked about. So it's a combination of better information, and then I think a different system of reimbursement that says, let's look at the overall quality of the care.
Behind the scenes, I got back to the CBS Bureau. I had never interviewed the president before, and someone in the old timer says, do you realize the President of the United States asked you a question in the middle of the system? That never happens. I said, I didn't quite go humana, 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 but, you know, believe me, the humana, humana, humana was in my head. But anyway, it said to me, I blogged about this too, I said, you know, the fact that he asked me a question, I really didn't think it was disingenuous. I thought that it just showed, whatever your politics, that he was intellectually curious. You know, I'm a doctor, I was there, he figured he'd ask me. So I found that interesting. Not all medical stories lend themselves to character-driven segments, but boy, it sure makes for better television, and it's part of the thing that makes us choose things. Nothing is more important or more moving than Alzheimer's.
I'll perk up.
I can't perk up.
During 5 decades of marriage, Mike Daly worked in law enforcement, while his wife, Carol, worked at everything else.
She raised my kid. She had a job. She cleaned house. She did the wash. She made the beds. And she put up with me. All that's changed for us is the roles.
Now it's Mike who runs the house. He feeds Carol,
okay.
Even puts on her makeup. She has Alzheimer's, diagnosed 7 years ago. When I first met the Dalys in 2008,
I don't know.
Carol's memory was slipping.
Let me ask you a question. How old are you?
65, yeah.
Now?
How old are you?
How old am I?
How old?
80? No, I don't know.
Even back then, this tough cop was feeling the strain.
And I saw a lot of stuff out there. But this is the worst. It's hard to deal with.
3 years later, Daly has gained 15 pounds, takes medications for anxiety and sleep, and knows he should exercise, but just can't find the time. Mike Daly is one of the nearly 15 million Americans providing 17 billion hours of unpaid Alzheimer's care a year. As a result, they're more likely to develop health problems of their own, such as depression and high blood pressure.
There are many cases that are reported where an individual becomes a caregiver for someone with Alzheimer's disease, and in fact they will die before the person with Alzheimer's disease because of the care-related stress.
Do you think this is taking a toll on you?
I'd probably be lying to say no, but of course, you know, it does take a toll. But it's life.
Finding that help early is going to give you the best opportunity to cope with the disease.
There's going to be a time, I know it's coming, when I will need help.
Meanwhile, the toll on him mounts as her condition declines.
It's the best I can do.
But their love remains stronger than ever. Dr. John LaPook, CBS News, New York.
Bob and Carol Daly, he's a tough Staten Island cop, amazing guy, and I've stayed close with them. When the shootings happened recently, tragically, there's a lot of misinformation and a lot of wrong thinking about mental illness. And here's a piece that we did.
4 years ago, Zach Poliano was a fun-loving teenager. He had plenty of friends and played in a rock band. His mother, Laura, remembers when he suddenly became paranoid.
I would come home and bang on my own door after work every day. Please let me in. It's your mom. It's your mom. And finally, I would crawl through my window.
He would lock you out.
He would lock me out. And then one day, horribly, literally, he opened the door to me, and I could tell by the look on his face that he did not know who I was.
Eventually, Zach made a confession.
He said, did you know I've been hearing voices for a year?
And what went through your head?
Well, I said, my darling, why? Why would you not tell your own mother I would never turn away from you? He said, because no one wants a crazy person.
Zach's fear of telling anyone about the voices delayed his diagnosis. he had schizophrenia. This is Zach Poliano today. He still loves music, but the disease has forced him to put his life on hold. He's been hospitalized several times.
Were the voices criticizing you in any way?
Yes, I could tell you that they were. It was a man voice and a woman voice picking on me.
Schizophrenia usually strikes young adults between the ages of 16 and 30. Not only can they hear voices, they may also suffer from visual hallucinations, delusions, and extreme paranoia. Zach can appear robotic and emotionless. Those are symptoms of the disease. The medication he takes can worsen those symptoms and also cause weight gain.
Do you think there's a stigma attached to having mental illness?
Of course. People will judge you, and especially after someone gets assaulted by a crazy guy. I could be that crazy guy.
Zach has never been violent. While about 95% of violence is committed by people with no serious mental illness, those with schizophrenia are 2 to 4 times more likely to commit violence than the average person. Studies have shown that proper treatment significantly lowers that risk. 5 days a week, Zach goes to an outpatient treatment program at Johns Hopkins Bayview Medical Center in Baltimore.
So I will see you tomorrow.
Krista Baker is his therapist.
We need to look at Zach every single day. We need to make sure that he's taking medicine because that makes him think clearly. The longer that we can get Zach to be doing well, the better the prognosis that he has.
Do you feel you're on the right track?
Yes, very much so.
In what way?
I'm a 21-year-old man, and I would like to have a steady life with a job and maybe a family someday.
What was the biggest misconception that you had?
That I could fix it. That if I tried hard enough, he would regain his health and he would be exactly like he was. And that's very hard to accept.
Zach's story is a reminder that the stigma attached to mental illness makes people ashamed to admit their symptoms. Until that stigma is erased, there will continue to be a delay in the proper diagnosis and treatment of psychiatric disease.
It took a lot of courage for them to talk to us. Doc, thanks for it.
I will say it's so important to go into a story without any preconceived notions. In this case, we had done a lot of research. I had spoken to a bunch of people, and I realized, which seems obvious now, that yes, there is an increased risk of violence in people with schizophrenia, but guess what? It's much, much lower when you're treated, and oh yeah, they don't get treatment because of the stigma, and you have this vicious cycle. So when he said, I could be that crazy guy, I just practically fell over. The story was exactly what we thought it was going to be beforehand, but it is important to not have preconceived notions and to tell the story as it is. This is an example of, and this will be the last long piece, advocate, reporter, at some point, the story that you choose to do becomes, in a way, advocacy, because you're there's a million different stories you could choose to follow. This was one of half a dozen stories that we did about the drug shortage, which was, if you remember, cancer drugs and other drugs that were in short supply.
We've been telling you about a nationwide shortage of life-saving cancer drugs for children. The Food and Drug Administration tells us that 14 drugs are in short supply. Now, here's something we wondered about. 15 months ago, Republicans and Democrats introduced bills in the Congress to solve the problem. The Preserving Access to Life-Saving Medications Act would require drug companies to notify the FDA if a shortage is coming. Both parties and the president support the bills, yet they haven't passed. We asked Dr. John LaPook to tell us about the shortage and then go to a place he'd never worked before, the U.S. Capitol.
When you're 10 months old and fighting leukemia, like Elena, this is what a good day looks like. 80% of children with her kind of cancer can be cured with the right medications. But 2 months ago, her dad, Mark Schoeneveld, was told her chemotherapy drug, methotrexate, was running out.
You know, you just pray that that stuff is handled by the professionals and that people do their jobs and get it done.
But it's not getting done. Dozens of cancer drugs are running out. The reasons include manufacturing problems and reduced production due to lower profits with generic drugs. FDA Commissioner Dr. Margaret Hamburg.
The industry has to not be afraid to let the FDA know if they have a problem so that we can get in there and work with them to fix it before it results in a shortage.
The FDA says the two bills that have been languishing in Congress would help fix the problem.
You're saying pass it and
we met with sponsors of the legislation, Republican Senator Susan Collins, Democratic Senator Amy Klobuchar, and Representatives Diana DeGette, a Democrat, and Tom Rooney, a Republican.
Can you explain this to Americans? You have something that's truly life-saving. You have both parties agreeing on it, and yet it cannot get brought to a vote.
I don't know what has to happen for people to recognize that this has to happen.
Why would we turn our backs on these patients and on the medical community who needs this help when we know something works?
Why does it take months and months? Why not today?
I've been in Congress 16 years. I have never seen a Congress where it was more difficult to pass legislation. I think you should call the leadership and ask them why they haven't brought this bill up for a vote.
So we did. We showed up at Speaker of the House John Boehner's weekly press briefing.
Why is it that legislation that everybody agrees is desperately needed is taking so long to pass?
The Congress is working on this. The Senate is getting ready to move a bill. The Energy and Commerce Committee is getting ready to mark up a bill in early May. But I would also ask, where's the administration been? Where's the President of the United States been?
When we spoke to the legislators, they said to talk to you about the leadership.
I respect the committee process. And the committees have their work to do to investigate this.
Remember, that committee process began over a year ago. During that year, another of Elena's drugs has hit the shortage list, leucovorin. She needs it to soften chemo's toxic effects.
The leucovorin doses, I can't imagine what it would be like without it. When you have diaper rash that's literally an open wound over your whole bum, it's like screaming in pain. It's horrible.
Legislation has now cleared a committee, but still needs a vote by the full Senate. Senate Majority Leader Harry Reid.
Explain to me why it takes 14 months since that first bill was introduced before anything is even beginning to look like it's going to happen.
Well, you know, as I said, things take a long time. That's when someone's been a governor in the state, they come to Congress and they go, wow, what's going on here? But that's the way we've always been.
As one of the leaders, can you go and talk to somebody and say, come on, move it along? I mean,
I would say this. First of all, things have happened. We'll have it on the floor soon. It's a step in the right direction. But there's no way that I or anyone else can explain how slowly things move here in the Senate. It's been that way for 230 years.
Fortunately, Elena has not yet missed any medicine, but others have. This legislation, while not the entire solution, is at least a step
in the right direction. Two, three weeks after our piece aired, they passed the bill, and it became law in July, and drug shortages went down about 40%, something like that after that. Just quickly and for fun, it's not all on network. There's blogging, there's the web, and I had a thing called cbsdoc.com. We did about 75 segments.
Do you believe that each individual American should be required to have health insurance?
I have come to that conclusion.
We live in a state where people can have different points of view.
I'm not asking for a free ride. I'm just asking for an affordable ride.
Dara Torres, Olympic champion swimmer, is going to tell us how to stay fit after 40.
So, I have to ask you at some point. I know everybody does. I mean, the abs.
Do you want to see them?
I'd love to see the abs. What kind of a camp is this?
Weight challenged camp.
Fat camp.
Does the term fat camp make anybody feel uncomfortable?
Out here.
You can wear a bikini without getting made fun of.
Here's your chance to get up close and personal, and I mean really up close and personal, with Dr. John LaPook.
Everybody should really consider how to prevent and screen for colorectal cancer, and colonoscopy is really the most effective way.
Now we're coming across the transverse colon, and this is usually one of the nicest views of the colon.
Today, I'm going to be having an upper endoscopy.
All right, John, you're going to feel just a little tickle in the back here. That's the tongue. Okay, we're heading down. Just enter the esophagus.
You've seen your dermatologist, but has your dermatologist seen you?
We're going to check your back.
Unless you've taken all your clothes off and the dermatologist has looked at every millimeter of your body, you have not been adequately screened for skin cancer.
Everybody wants to be Superman in the bedroom, but of course, that's not always possible. But with the help of Dr. Harry Fish, we're going to try to get you to at least the level of, say, Clark Kent. Do you think guys know where everything is?
No.
So how do we overcome this evolutionary wiring that you say we have that makes us want to have sex very quickly and then run away so that we can linger longer and have the woman have more pleasure?
I have no idea.
You guys seem to have a very good sense of humor about sex. Is that important?
Yeah, I don't think so.
Have you ever had a really huge laugh during sex?
Yes, last night.
So you think that medical marijuana should be legalized?
Absolutely. This is a medicine with a 5,000-year history, with literally no negative consequences. How could we possibly hold this back?
Is that true? There are literally no negative consequences?
Absolutely not. That's an absurd statement without meaning to be disrespectful.
And thank you very much for watching another episode of CBSDoc.com. I'm Dr. John LaPook. Good day and good health. Which was a toss to Edward R. Murrow's good night and good luck. So clearly I'm not being a journalist here. This was fun on the streets. I am pointing the camera at myself. The Bernie Sanders thing is interesting. At the time with the death squads, remember during the debate, the death squads, everybody, all this stuff is going on with the town hall. I just went up to Arlington, Vermont with the camera and sat there for 2 hours. It was the most peaceful talk you ever heard in your whole life. And so, of course, you never heard about it. So you only hear about the ones that have good sound bites. And finally, why I'm still doing it, staying high on the learning curve. I mean, it's amazing how much you learn. Amazing continuing medical education. It really does help my clinical practice, which I froze, by the way, when I came here because I figured it would just explode. So I don't see any new patients. But I do some new procedures. But in terms of my internal medicine, I do a lot of internal medicine and GI. That's it. Whoever I have is who I have, with rare exception. Possibility of making a difference, people letting you into their lives, the fun, and then two, you got to see this wonderful
moment. In a tent
moment.
Camp in Port-au-Prince, Haitians are resuscitating one of the earthquake's cruelest casualties, childhood.
Oh, I'm vraiment triste. I'm very sorry. A friend of yours died?
On January 12th, 11-year-old Toscani lost her friend and her home. Now an organization called Film Aid is helping to bring some magic into her life with an outdoor screen and a movie projector. At this camp, more than 1,000 people came to see the Disney film Up.
Why did you come tonight? To come to see the film.
When you see a child laughing uncontrollably, it's like they're not in fear, they're not frightened, they're not hurting, they're not hungry, they're laughing.
Who likes the film? Qui aime film là?
And then finally, very, very finally.
And at nursing homes like Cobble Hill in Brooklyn, Sylvia Karolitsky and other patients are pushed to keep their minds and bodies active, to delay.
Oh, I hope that starts up again. The swirly ball of light. Uh-oh. Hold on a second. Ignore. Wait. No, I'm getting that. Hold on a second. We'll cheat.
And at nursing homes like Cobble Hill in Brooklyn, Sylvia Karolitsky and other patients are pushed to keep their minds and bodies active, to delay further decline.
What does music do for you in a place like this?
Well, at least it cheers me up a little bit.
You'll never know, dear, how much I love you. Please don't take my sunshine away.
I like that song.
The very last slide, which I'm not going to bring up since PowerPoint, thank God, bombed out at the very end, was when all else fails, the Hippocratic Oath always trumps the Nielsen ratings. Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay to get your questions?
Absolutely.
Okay.
I have no...
Thank you. That was really moving, and I was both the Haiti episodes that you showed. I know so many of our students have wanted to go to Haiti, and it's been on the do not travel list, and I'm sure they're going to ask you some questions about it. But also the shortage of medicines is something that you really made a difference. And I think it's inspiring to realize that your questioning really can change something. So thank you so much. We would like to give you a chance to ask some questions because I think that's always one of the most fun parts of the Foard lecture. So we'll take a few questions, and if you want to just go to the mics and
I know it went late, but I'm fine. I don't have to be. I'm not leaving till tomorrow. And if people want to stay, I'll stay. And so.
So if you would just say your name, it would be great. Questions?
Any questions? Really? Well, it's a good thing I went through the whole amount then.
Okay, well, we will, John will be out in the lobby where we invite you to join us for food, and it's local foods. Wait,
no, we have a question.
Okay. Miriam LeBach, a physician.
Miriam LeBach, I think our last
names are Oh, yeah. Probably the same guy at Ellis Island changed it.
Yeah, well, that's it. Same. We'll talk about it. The question I had is the drama is always better TV, as you pointed out. There's so many preventive health problems. How do you balance what you know has to be out there in terms of preventive health and the dramatic Haiti type
I
situation?
I struggle with this all the time, and in fact, I watched on the plane right up a wonderful moving documentary by Betsy Arledge about the HIV epidemic and how black Americans, especially black American women, have it, and you don't hear that story told too often. Generally, we do stories where there's a peg, a news peg, something happened, and we report it and put it in perspective. To do an enterprise story where you're going to just say, you know, this is something that needs to be told is tough. It's a tough sell because, first of all, the segments are a minute and a half, 2 minutes long in a 22-minute broadcast. Those take a little longer. I mean, we did a Where America Stands on Alzheimer's. The day of the earthquake, by the way, is when it aired, which was 6 minutes long, which was astounding that we had that much time. But generally, we don't have that much time. It's a real tough sell. It's a real issue. It's a problem to try to get these many important preventative medicine issues on the evening news. I mean, and it's something that I think about maybe during the daytime, in the morning. Hopefully, there'll someday be a little bit more a time for that and an arena for that.
Thank you for what you do.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Vishal. I'm a pharmacy student here at UNC, and I just wanted to know, I mean, you've been able to really combine both medicine and journalism, and I'm thinking upon graduation of doing something similar. You know, could you just go into something briefly how how did you balance that, and when did that actually become official where you said, you know what, now is the time to launch journalism?
I didn't. It's just, like, that's why it was an accident. I never thought of becoming a journalist. I never thought about becoming a public health person, but Katie called me and I said, sure, whatever. Yeah. But I did realize, I will say at the very beginning, that you don't want to be a dilettante and that there's nothing more precious than your patients. So I immediately froze my practice. I have a full-time nurse. I have two other people working in my office. I see people from 8 to 12 or 8 to 1. And I think that the secret to doing both is to not keep growing the medical practice and to just understand you have to make this little universe. And I would never stop being a doctor, never. Because, I mean, I love it. I love the medicine. I love my patients. I have responsibility to them. They signed up. I've been a doctor 32 years. They came on board thinking they had their doctor. So I think when people are thinking about combining their careers, I don't think you never want to jump away from medicine. And also it gives it legitimacy, and it's more fun. I mean, I read these things, and I say, I'm going to go back. A couple of weeks ago, there was a great story about dementia and hearing loss? It turns out that people who have hearing loss have a 25% increase. This was people 70 to 79 years old. Two-thirds of them almost had hearing loss significant enough to alter their communication. And they had a 25% increased risk of early dementia. I immediately put that into practice in my practice because of two possible reasons. I mean, there were some reasons why this could be, but two possibilities are this cognitive load business, that your brain is working so hard to hear that it has less processing power to think. So, and the other, of course, is that people who are deaf become isolated and lonely, and that your brain actually can shrink, and that could be another reason for dementia, which made me think, there's a reason why giving them a hearing aid could actually, you know, for the person, not if you have Alzheimer's, but the person who just is on the cusp, maybe it prevents them, maybe it delays them. That's not certain, by the way. The professor who did this at Hopkins said, we're not sure they're testing that. But it was something that I was very excited about that I could do right away, you know, because my older people, of course, they're thinking hearing aid, they're thinking granny, the horn, you know. And so then I was able to say to them, look, hearing aid or the possibility of preventing dementia.
Thank you.
Or hearing aid or dementia.
So we'll take Lauren.
Lauren Thee, I'm an environmental science alum, and I really enjoyed your presentation. It's so helpful to hear more about how people communicate science. And so my question was, well, I have two questions. The first one was just, how are you able to incorporate what's known about how people just retain science information or able to learn about science topics into how you report? And then also, what do you think are some of the most important questions as far as things we don't know about how people take in science or able to use it in their lives?
I don't know what the science is. I just figure logically, I try to make it to a level where my patients could understand it. I mean, I don't know. I'm sure there's a big science behind how you present it. We try to make it so that it's clear, so that it's, you know, you have some illustrations that there's a character they can identify with, but I just pretty much figure if my 16-year-old son can understand it, that's probably my best guide.
So I think we'll thank John and.
Thank you. Thank you very much for.
And you're willing to continue the conversations
Sure.
out. Eating local foods, and I want to invite you all April 10th, 2014, to come hear Greg Allgood, who's an alumnus of our Environmental Sciences Department and the recipient of this year's Distinguished Alumnus Award, and he's going to talk about the remarkable journey that he was part of to climb Mount Kilimanjaro this year on behalf of clean water, and it's he carried the logos of his company, Procter & Gamble and UNC Chapel Hill. And so I think it'll be another great talk. And thank you all for coming. And let's talk more out in the lobby.
Thanks a lot.
Thank you so much. That was really good.